Here we go. This special episode of Cop Block Radio is filmed live in Keene, New Hampshire. We are live in the studio with Severin Freeman, Lehigh Valley Cop Block.
We got Rick R. Ricardo Gonzalez from Allentown Cop Block. And
J.P. Freeman and Ethan Glover from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block.
We decided to take this trip down here in honor of the studio being raided by a bunch of punks with badges. The guys came down, came into this studio, ran up in it. I wish I had been present because I would have given them a nice piece of my mind, but I live all the way in Pennsylvania, but I made plans as soon as I heard what happened to get down here.
Me and Ethan were coblocking until 5 a.m., literally an hour before they showed up here.
So you were asleep when it happened?
Not really. We just got home when it happened.
Did you make it up here?
No, we didn't even know. Until I woke up at 12:30, that's when I knew that the place got raided. No phone calls, no radio calls, nothing.
Well, by some kind of libertarian genie magic, Ian has the studio up and running again.
Yeah, I guess their cell phones were taken and everything was taken, so they couldn't communicate with anybody.
Well, I mean, I just see it as a miracle that the station was able to be up and running so quickly, that the support that poured in was so awesome. I came down here because
he's a genius.
I decided, you know, I've been putting off a trip down here. I want to see the Shire. It's time to come down here, visit, see the local cop lockers, get familiar with the area, and I want to go say hi to those feds. I really want to go find them.
You got to go to Virginia.
No, they're not out of Virginia. Those feds came out of a local office. I want to go find that office and say hi. Everybody says I'm insane. They said that they're going to put me in a dark cage or a black site. Nobody will know where I'm at.
That'd be nice. Do you know if anybody around here knows if there's a federal office, FBI office here?
I don't know. I planned on just looking it up. I figured that somebody would know. I would guess that on the warrant itself, it would have said what office it was out of.
Virginia.
Does it? The warrant?
No. It was Boston.
Ah, Boston. That's still far.
Not really. It's not too far from here.
Maybe we'll stop on our way back. I don't know. I just really want to alert the local public of who the real criminals are, because the FBI ran a child porn site, as a lot of people who listen to this station know. They were reported on by this radio station, and it's suspected that since the time frame was a week later, that is why they chose to raid. That is why they chose to choose this studio, this place, to come into and push around to let everybody know.
There's a lot of other things going on, too, not cop lock related, more community liberty related, which I've lost a ton of friends over this stupid petition. And, you know, you've been keeping up with what's going on.
Yeah, the whole Free State project and everything going on with them. That's the other thing that I wanted to come into town for. Because I had a couple days where I was like, you know what, Keene's not worth it. Moving there's not worth it. Signing that thing, I publicly said I rescind my signature. I no longer
Jessica, my wife, Jessica Phillips, or Liberty Lady, she's an early mover, and she rescinded her name. She wants nothing to do with FSP anymore.
Well, I mean, I
she came here from Texas.
I know that you have posted stuff still supporting moving here. I know Ian has supported still moving here and supports the movement still happening. So I really wanted to come and just see where all the drama is. Like, are these people even anything in this town that you even need to worry about? Because to me, it sounds like it's a small group that's just a bunch of troublemakers.
Well, the group that you're thinking of has nothing to do with what's going on with FSP. They're just a hate group that basically specifically targets people and fills them up with lies, and they just make fun of them basically on their websites and on their threads.
Are you talking about the Stop Free Keene movement?
Yeah, and I filed a Superior Court lawsuit against them today on a federal injunction because they left a recorder inside the closed hearing during my family case, and I was approached by Detective Joel Chichester this morning at our house because the court filed the charge against them.
Oh, that's fantastic. So you got woken up to police at your door
at 9 o'clock.
Somebody committed a crime against you.
Yeah, at 9 o'clock. Me being a victim, yeah.
I think I would have just told him to kick rocks, but I don't know. I don't really.
Well, the filing is real. I filed it today. And you know, I'm labeled like this JP's just going to sue you. I've only went after two people since I've been up here, and they were both state agencies.
Did you hear about our lawsuit?
No.
We got we won in court. Did I tell you about that?
No.
Oh, man. We went to, for our arrest, me and Rick and our friend Scott, we're all filming outside of police state police barracks in Pennsylvania, and the guys just walked out and arrested us for no reason whatsoever.
You too?
Yeah.
Yeah, all three of us.
What did they do to you?
They did the most to him. He didn't have an ID on him, so they subjected him to...
Did you pull the race card on him?
Nah, they...
they really wanted to ID him, I'll tell you that much. They took him... He had ID on him, just not a legal state ID. He had his insurance card and everything.
You don't have to have one here.
They wouldn't take none of that. They're like, no, we're fingerprinting you. We want to see who you really are. They were determined. Well, yeah. They ended up losing. They got beat. We had two really, really good lawyers that wanted this case to make an example out of the state police. They support being able to film cops and everything.
It's nice to win.
It was really nice to have. It's like a big law firm out of Philly that you Google them and they tear apart cops left and right for their misdeeds. So this guy, they took my case and they took our case and they won in court and it was awesome.
Well, that's the thing. And that's the thing with this Stop Free King group. When you have an entity just like the police that specifically target people, I think it's wrong. Lawfully, it's wrong and it's illegal. They shouldn't be able to just target people and be okay, this person's this, and this, and put it on an open forum when 90% of it's just not true. You just can't do that. Me not being that libertarian, I'm heading that way. I know a lot of folks are like, oh, we don't use the state. We try to use arbitraries and mediations. Screw that. If they love the state and they're statist and they're coming after you, I'm going to use the state to the fullest ability to teach them what the state is all about. So if you're going to come after me,
give them a little taste of their own medicine.
Exactly. And this injunction,
I can kind of see the logic in that.
Yeah, this injunction that I filed today is basically it's a discretionary lawsuit to pull the video and whatever they've been posting. And it's got a couple restraining orders and like three or four co-defendants that I think could be detrimental to my children. And an immediate threat. Now, the
I
federal,
find it really, really ironic. This happens a lot.
It does.
That the cop supporters are more dangerous than the cops themselves. They're out there. I've had my life threatened.
I've had
my family's photos put all over sites and like my house address and like paperwork about me.
When
put
you're
over
cop
websites.
Blocking, when you're cop blocking, Rick, do you notice that most of the people that stick up for the police, they're like drunk out of their mind?
Yeah, they're idiots.
I haven't ran into one yet, but I did run into one that wasn't even from Allentown, and he stopped to question me why I was filming the police in Allentown.
There's a lot of videos on YouTube happening. Actually, a funny one that I just thought of. Recently, Brian Sumner put one up from Fresno, California, about he was filming this drunk guy getting roughed up and arrested. And then for the next 10 minutes while the cops are getting everything together to take him away, this guy sees Brian and seems to film's F the police shirt and just goes nuts. I'm in the backseat and I support these guys. They're doing their job. It was the funniest thing. This guy that's cognitive dissonance at its best. You're in the back of a car for consuming something you're allowed to consume that haven't done anything wrong other than consuming too much of it, according to them. Right. But you're still going to stand by and support them and scream your praises. Well, we will be right back with our top stories of the night. An awesome story update out of New York on this special episode of Cop Block Radio. Welcome back. Cop Block Radio. Ethan has a story for us coming up. It's our top story of the night. Last week we talked about the cops in New York that stopped a mailman and arrested him while he was delivering mail. The story went viral, and the story of who these cops actually are came to light over the last week. So go ahead and take it.
Yeah, so this was apparently the reason for the arrest on this was that he basically yelled at the officers for cutting him off. You know, and this was, I got the list of the names of police officers here. It's Luis Machado, Lazar Luco, Miguel Rodriguez, and David Sevilla on the 71st Precinct in New York. And apparently this isn't their first. They've had a lot of issues in the past, according to this story. It says in the last 6 years, three of the four officers involved in his arrest have been named as defendants in federal civil suits from false arrest to other forms of misconduct, which is exactly what this situation was, a false arrest, as the precinct has already agreed.
So the precinct actually came out not in support of the officers' action.
Right, so right now the Internal Affairs is pushing forward with there needs to be some sort of disciplinary action on these officers.
Wow, this never happened. So what did it take?
It's really just the video. I think it made it pretty obvious.
Didn't it come to light now that these officers, this isn't their first time?
Yeah, well, I don't see any what their past issues are, but it sounds like this is something they do a lot, where they'll, any minor issue, stop people, and these guys were not even in uniform. They were in plain clothes arresting somebody. There's no way for that mailman to know who they are. It could have been anyone.
I hope the mailman got a lawyer. I want to see a big lawsuit from that.
I'm pretty sure he will.
So these guys, it turns out that they have several complaints against them, right, Rick? Were looking this up earlier, too. You were telling me about this on the drive over.
Yeah, they got a history of civil rights violations and complaints on them. And I'm surprised they're still on the streets.
Well, because they messed with ordinary citizens every other time. And this time they messed with a federal employee while he was on the clock.
Isn't it a federal offense to tamper with the mail?
I know. If I grabbed the mail, man, that's a federal offense.
There's actually a whole separate thing you got to deal with as far as arresting a federal employee, especially on the job. They can't leave that truck unsecured, which is what they did.
Yeah. They left that thing wide open.
Right. Exactly.
Yep. And not only that, they were also taunting him while he was in custody, like bad-mouthing him and, you know, just being real assholes.
This poor guy, he's out there delivering mail and in his postal uniform with a bag over his shoulder, almost gets hit by a car. He probably didn't even know it was cops at first.
No, he didn't.
Because it was an undercover cop car and plainclothes officer.
Yeah.
Oh, well, you just messed with the gang. We're undercover today. Wow. So
they get yelled at. They were offended, so they had to arrest the guy.
Well, I mean, I guess for anybody who wants accountability, this looks good, but it's a matter of these officers
need to be off the streets for good.
Yeah, well, they're getting off the streets now, but what about criminal prosecution? They might get charged. I want to see if they actually get convicted.
But guess who actually faces the consequences? It's taxpayers paying out to the city. It's not like the officers.
Yeah, how does that work?
Yeah, exactly.
Does the federal dollars pay him, or does state dollars pay him? Or
probably,
does both?
It'd probably be the state. Definitely not the officers. They're not going to feel the real consequences if they're ruled against. It never happens that way.
Well, I mean, he's able to get, I'm sure he's on workman's comp at this point, so it's nice to know that he's actually, I don't know if he's delivering mail still, but I can't imagine you go back to work after something like that happens.
I'm pretty sure he still has his job, because the video doesn't lie. The man did nothing wrong. He was out doing his job, and they just came along and just asked him for ID, and when he refused to show his ID, I guess they just started handcuffing him and taking him away.
Yeah.
And you can see in the video, one of the officers telling the postal guy, you know, we don't want to hurt you. We're going to hurt you.
what really stood out to me even more than the arrest was the people's reaction. People aren't staying silent anymore. It was almost broke down.
Pissed.
They had to get out of there quick. There was about to be something breaking off. Yeah. So they were gonna. Somebody was gonna go after those cops. That's why they got them into the car as fast as they could and took off and left the postal car unattended.
Yep. Well, all the mail, people's mail in it.
Wow. Well, it's good to know that they're gonna be off the job, but I want to see them all
hopefully,
off the job.
Yeah.
I'm not with the accountability movement anymore. I want to see abolishment.
There's been no change in status for these guys. They haven't been transferred or fired or suspended, nothing. And I guess the 71st Precinct, there's been 15 complaints so far this year. Last year, there were 78 total made by
civilians. So far this year, there's 15 complaints.
Well, there's plenty more to go, I'm sure.
Wow.
Listen, that's not the only...
And those are just the ones that come forward. What about the people that just say it's not worth it and let it go?
Yeah, oh, well. Exactly.
I'm pretty sure
New York's one of those states that we drove past New York today, and I wanted to stop and film some cops. And Rick's like, I don't know, man. We might get dead.
New York is pretty hardcore.
Yeah, New York. Yeah. Rick's like, you can't just pull out a camera and film them in New York. They're gonna get you. They'll come after you.
Yeah, you see that one riding the ATV-wheeler. He's riding his ATV. What's those things called? The four-wheelers?
The ATV?
ATVs, yeah. Cop just pulls up and points his gun at him.
Wow.
Like, random.
Yeah, I think I saw that video. He walked up and just pulled his gun right away.
This is how he starts a traffic stop, just pulls out the gun.
It wasn't even a traffic stop.
The guy was stopped. He was chilling.
The cop just pulls up next to him and just points his pistol at him.
Yeah, I guess they got a call, a complaint that he was riding around. The guy had stopped at this point. He was standing next to his ATV. The cop pulls up, pulls his gun out, and just starts waving it around. It's all on video, acting like a maniac.
What's that?
Oh, it happened out here?
Oh, this was the... Wow. This is a cop who pulled her gun on her husband, I believe. And she just went in. I don't think there are any... As far as I know, there weren't any criminal charges. She went to some sort of training, you know, and came back a few months
later.
Safety
training class.
Yeah, exactly.
Two half-day weekends, and you're good to go. Pulled out a gun and threatened somebody's life. Meanwhile, if one of us pull a gun,
Winchester.
If one of us even touches a gun, if it's on our hip legally, they can try to say they feared for their lives.
Oh, yeah. I just saw a video earlier on coplock.org of a... These cops were at an apartment building. Had a security camera down on the stairwell. Dog comes out of the
door. Oh, man, this is the worst story.
He's being friendly, wagging his tail, and the dude just backs off, shoots him, and walks down the stairs. He's hidden for the rest of the video. He's hiding out.
Yeah, we were going to talk about that tonight, so we could jump into that. This was one of the most, you know, I see this video right after I see a police supporter page that posted about dog lives. About their police dog lives, meaning like they want criminal charges steeper if you hurt a police dog.
Yeah.
And I see this video right afterwards of this cop shooting a dog who's wagging his tail. This dog was literally wagging his tail.
Just
it looked like
friendly.
He was smiling, friendly dog. Like,
obviously not a threat.
What is wrong with these cowards? They're cowards. As JP would say, cowards.
We'll be right back.
We'll be right back with more. Cop Block Radio. We are back. Trying to hold it together here. With our special live edition from the LRN Studios. JP's losing it.
Oh, we're just having fun, man.
What a night. What a week.
Dude, I just drove 5 hours here. That was an exciting...
Hey, I made the trip too, bro.
That was exciting. You did not warn me that Connecticut was like Nazi Germany.
We didn't go through Connecticut.
Yeah. Or wait, what state was that? Not Connecticut.
Rhode Island?
No, it's...
No, Brian, it was Mass. Connecticut. It was Connecticut.
Connecticut's pretty beefed up, too.
We came up through Connecticut. They have some gray undercover SUVs.
That's Connecticut.
And it was on both sides of the road, and they were just literally, like, they were one after another parked, and they were literally just grabbing every out-of-state driver one after another. And I managed to slip through because the car behind me was from New York. They grabbed the car behind me and didn't get me. I get to the other side, and I'm looking at my GPS and see that the road opens up. I'm like, I am out. I need to get out of the state right now. That was messed up. Like, where
they had one person.
How is that even legal?
I don't even
it
know.
Shouldn't
but
they it shouldn't
they
be.
They had somebody with New Hampshire tags.
It's specific. It's specific targeting, man. I keep telling you, man.
They had this poor girl with New Hampshire tags. I felt like pulling over.
Sitting on the guardrail, confused on what the hell is going on. This cop is just tearing up her car.
Yeah, all her blankets
all
and
her,
everything.
Everything on the side of the road.
I really,
that could be your house, man.
I really wanted to pull over and try to film and be there for support.
That's not even right.
Excuse me.
I had possible legality issues driving through that state, so I didn't want to mess with it.
Yeah, that's how I am in Mass. I can't do shit in Mass.
Yeah, I just didn't want to. I did not want to encounter the cops until I got here safely.
If you owe $5 to the state of Mass, you will have a warrant out for your arrest.
Hmm.
Really?
Yep.
Well, it's all about the money, right?
They'd rather spend $22,000 and prosecuting a case than to just sit on the $5.
Yeah, well, Pennsylvania's no better. They just, Matt, our other co-host that's usually on, just had his case. He goes to court for a DUI that he didn't have. His blood work showed that he was clean. And he gets there and his lawyer's like, yeah, you don't have to plead to this. You're innocent. Your blood work is clean. Well, the DA decides to move forward with the case anyway.
Jeez.
Isn't his job supposed to be to say if there's a case or not?
I'm sorry, Matt.
I think he
Mr.
beat that.
Taylor, we love you, but damn.
He beat that.
They rigged you, man.
Yeah, he beat it. He beat it.
Yeah.
So right there in preliminary, he didn't even have to move up to the next court.
The lawyer did basically what our lawyer did. Just went in there and just...
There was nothing a lawyer needed to do. All he had to do was open up the paper and say, hey, look, blood report is clean. There's nothing there. They tried to say he was drunk.
That's crazy. Well, first, before we go any further, I just want to tell the folks that we have Severin Freeman and Ricky from Allentown Cop Lock and
Lehigh Valley Cop Lock.
Lehigh Valley and Ethan Glover and myself, we're doing an event from today till Saturday, and tomorrow morning we're going to be doing Don't Take a Plea. And then court outreach in the court and show them the ropes about how the court system works here during the arraignment day. And they got a lot of arraignments tomorrow and how I get in cops' faces there and call out the prosecutors. It should be a fun time. We're going to go to Free Coast. And then Friday night, we're meeting up at 6 p.m. with co-founder of CopLock.org, Pete Ayer. And we're going to have dinner with him and sit down with some folks and have a great time CopLocking in Manchester. And we're going to hit Nashua as well. And then... maybe we will do the Free Coast later on tomorrow night. But it's going to be fun, man. I think you guys are going to have a blast.
You're going to have me needing a vacation after my vacation. I'm going to be worn out.
Bro, when we went up there, when me and Jess went up to the Lehigh Valley, man, I was done. Done. The drive killed me.
Dude, we stayed out till 3 in the morning.
After driving 5 hours straight, I literally cop locked with you till like 4:30. We didn't get back.
Yeah, it was pretty late.
And our ladies were gone for the count.
Yeah, we wanted to come back, but we just couldn't stop because one after another kept getting pulled over right in front of us. It was a good night.
And then you brought me to that Celtic Fest thing.
Oh, yeah. Bethlehem, Pennsylvania has some of the best festivals. You should see Music Fest. It's 10 times that size.
Wow.
I think they said...
Officer Peacock didn't like me, though.
Yeah, I remember Peacock. He's kind of funny.
The worst thing you can do to me, Sev... is tell me, oh, that guy picked on me once. What do you think JP's going to do?
I didn't even tell you that. I said, I don't like that guy. I was filming a traffic stop, and this guy had a suspended license, and they were going to tow his car. And I was just like, you know what? Dude, give me permission to drive your car. I'm a legal driver. And the cop wouldn't give me the keys. He's like, no, it's being towed. You can't do that. I was like, what do you mean you can't do that?
He's a dickhead.
And I tried to go get I was going to get in the car and drive off. Regardless of what he said,
I like the video Ricky had with the cop pushing me, and then after saying he didn't push me, he actually admitted it later,
yeah.
And then apologized.
Yeah, the cops, cops of our way are kind of fun.
I got him to incriminate himself.
They've been behaving really, really good lately, I got to tell you.
That was kind of funny.
My local cops have been on their best behavior. Same thing with Allentown cops, his town. Like, we put him in check. I made the police chief retire in the next town over from my town.
Yeah, but that doesn't count the hidden investigations, the stings, the warrant searches and stealing people's property. That doesn't count all the stuff that's behind the scenes that you don't see. And those are the things that we need to try to figure out how to get more video of. Instead of fake wannabe activists taking a little picture through their window this big. Oh, there's feds across the street. Let's stay in our house and not video record.
Oh, man. That's
not me.
Funny.
I'll be there as close as I can be to get them on tape.
Yeah, Rick's out there. He's a trooper. He's the only guy I've ever seen that rocks two cell phones at once. He does one.
You know who I wish was here, believe it or not? Dave Ridley.
Who's that?
He's an area activist that's been recording public officials for like forever.
Okay.
He is some of the things I don't agree with, but I love his videos. I would have liked to see his approach to a situation like that. I really would.
To the federal situation.
Yeah.
Well, from what I understood, there were people out there asking questions.
All you can see Renee Cade up on the video. You guys are a piece of shit.
All right, this is not my show, but I've got to interject here, kids. You guys are so adorable, you fucking casual noobs. Here I am on my porch, no cell phone, nothing, while the feds are raiding my fucking house. Like, let me just tell you guys, it was the scariest thing about it was the radio silence, because the first thing they did, they came in, they took everybody's phone, so no one could record what was going on in here. They wouldn't let me in my house once I show up. Nobody came outside,
across
really.
Across the street, they were watching the whole thing
they
from their window.
They didn't know what was going on, and they certainly didn't want to get involved. But they're not like us. I came outside, and I'm like, you motherfuckers need to answer some questions right now. But they wouldn't tell you what was going on anyways. So the best thing I could do was stand outside and just run my fucking mouth at them, because there was nothing else I could do. But my first concern,
were you
going
screaming?
Back, I was bullshit.
You didn't see the video?
Once I realized they were FBI, I was bullshit. I'm like, you need to get my fucking dog out here right now, because I was convinced they shot my dog.
Oh, man.
I had no idea. Once I saw they were feds, I was like, fuck, get my dog out here now.
Before you leave, introduce yourself and what show are you from?
Oh, this is Renee Kate from Anarchy After Dark. Hey, guys, what's up?
What's up?
Friday, LRN.FM,
that's called,
10
that's called
PM
Cop
midnight.
Block Radio Ambush right
motherfuckers
there.
Yeah. Ambushed.
hey, it's cool to get somebody firsthand that was actually here to experience the fun of the FBI.
Oh, you can definitely hear it, and I've witnessed it out on the street as well.
I'm surprised, you know, I am surprised that it's not more tore up. Like, I expect it. I don't know what I expected walking up to the house. I guess I expected like stuff knocked over and like broken windows and all kinds of craziness. Like, you never know. They come in and they do whatever they want.
They did the whole thing very delicately.
Well. That's because they know the cop lock
but
will report
thieves,
on them.
But they're thieves nonetheless.
Well, we're going to be right back with an insane invention someone made that's going to change cop locking possibly.
A stand-up toilet?
We are back, taking selfies in the studio during the commercial break.
Yeah, and vlogs.
We're totally shameless. And video blogs. Hey, listen, this is kind of exciting for me. You know what? I got involved in Cop Block about coming up on a year now. Before that, I was a registered Democrat. I'm sorry, guys.
Oh, just broke my heart.
Oh, man, I was a Democrat, yeah. But, yeah. So I get involved when I realize that things are just so bad. I never knew that there was anything like a free state or like a movement like this. I thought I was the only one that thought the way that I did. And I was happy to stand up for myself, for my rights at any time. But I never really knew that there was a whole movement of people doing this.
This seems to be the case in most places.
So, yeah, this is like
New Hampshire is something else.
This is like Vegas for me, I guess. I don't know. I don't know what you would consider it. Like the Holy Land. We're in the Holy Land.
The Holy Land of Liberty.
Well, considering the amount of activism that's been going on in Keene, I lived in Keene since 06. I was actually looking at it from a towny point of view, from the outside in, walking downtown and seeing 35 to 40 activists, and all of a sudden, like, a couple of them are getting arrested. I'm like, hey, what are they getting arrested for? Oh, they just wouldn't move. I'm like, what do you mean they wouldn't move? Oh, that one right there was wearing his hat. That one right there had a fake beer. And that one right there, I don't know what he did. They just arrested him just because. I'm like, what the fuck? What's going on here? People are getting arrested for, like, hats.
So that's what made you start to look into cop law?
No. My story is different. I actually met Pete coming out of court after one of the depositions of making a settlement agreement with the city of Keene and Keene Police Department from the lawsuit I had against him. And he overheard me, and I met him, and he gave me a card, and I'm like, oh, wow, check this out. And then he invited me to the Shire Free Church. I came here one night, met like 30 people that night. And I've been doing cop lock. He set up some event one August, and I went out with him, and I've been doing it ever since. I caught the bug. And I despise the profession so much already. It was just built in me already. But as far as the Keene activism goes, it's been going down, but it comes in waves. You see it come up, 50 activists, and then it goes down. Yeah, it's nothing to do with these Stop Free Keene idiots. They have nothing to do but pick on people.
That's the same thing that happens everywhere. Unfortunately, everybody wants to talk online and talk about how much things suck, but when there's an event or something to show up for, it's like twisting arms to get people to come out and actually stand up and do stuff.
Well, that's the thing. I think activists usually get burnt out because usually – if you see an activist, it's usually the same activist doing a ton of shit.
Yeah.
Like me and you.
Yeah.
Like me and you have down days where we're like, man, we just got blasted by every single group, cops. We're getting arrested. We're losing our house. They towed my car. Our kids are getting locked up. I mean, when bad things happen to people like me and you, they happen in like fives and sixes all at once. So the whole world crashes. So we need a break.
Yeah.
Me, I haven't taken one. Even through this whole family hearing
strangely
thing.
Strangely enough, this is my break.
That's what I'm saying.
This is my vacation.
That's what I'm saying.
I literally am on vacation right now.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, our break isn't a break.
Free State Project, for being a bunch of douches, because the reason I had the money for this vacation was because it was for Porkfest. Well, since Porkfest is canceled, I said I'm coming.
Well, the way I fucking look at it is they're an interim government, just like the state, that has a president, a board of directors that want to force control on free speech and free thought, and they're basically getting their facts wrong. I would really like to see the evidence that they had during that decision to pull FTL and lose all support to Ian Freeman and all the things that have to do with Free Talk Live and LRN FM Talk Radio, Liberty Radio Network.
You know, you can just let them dig their own graves. I mean, with or without the FSP as an organization, this is still the place to be. I mean, they're not the ones who have really built this. It's been a ground-up, you know, grassroots sort of movement. It's not the organization that's pulling people to the state.
Now, you guys are on the ground here. Can you explain, Rick was asking me this on the way up, what is the difference between Free Keene and Free State Project?
Well, Free Keene's a blog.
Okay.
I'm not a blogger, Free Keene. I've only associated with Ian Freeman because he's part of Keene Cop Lock. He does Keene Cop Lock. He's an admin on Keene Cop Lock. And my only association with Free Keene is because one of the cop lockers is a Free Keene blogger. And he just happens to host a national syndicate radio show. And how lucky was I to be involved in such a movement? And then you had the CAC next door at first, the Keene Activist Center, which was the birthplace or the incubation of coplock.org. This is where it happened, right here. This is where it incubated. And I think Pete Ayer made a video recently about Keene activism and how it started here. I learned
a lot of my knowledge of the storyline here through Derek J's video.
But to ask me about FSP and Free State Project, you don't have to ask my wife, because I'm kind of out of the loop on how they correlate one another, because it looked like an interim government from me from the beginning. And I said it last year at Porkfest while I was there. I'm like, this kind of seems like it's because I was reading the bylaws, and one of the bylaws of Porkfest was you are subject to have your car searched upon entry. And when I was reading that,
I want to know who's doing the searching if you're not allowing cops there.
The Rangers,
Porkfest security, and search
the
a car.
Rangers, right? Is that what they call?
What exactly would they be looking for?
Are they Rangers?
I think so.
Rangers, right?
I don't know. I mean, what are they going to find? I mean, everyone's got weed.
I kept FSP at an arm's length since I've been doing Coblog.
I don't know about any of it. All I know is that this town has a lot of activists. I like to go out and do activism. That's my main. That is my main goal to come here, is to have a bigger group than what I have out my way.
I mean, it's impressive. The things Rich Paul did with 420 and the 420 rallies, and then what was it? Titty Tuesdays with girls popping out their boobs downtown. And there's nothing the government could do about it. They're drinking games in City Hall. They have, they're just drinking water.
I'm in the Holy Land. This sounds perfect.
The civil disobedience and Derek J's, victimless crime spree. Most of that was here in Keene. And literally, you could see those videos. This is like 30, 35 plus people getting arrested. And then you got a demo who gets arrested for a hat.
Yeah.
I think it was Ian that got arrested for the hat. No, it was a demo. Yeah, it was a demo. And then he gets nailed for talking about his friend getting arrested for the hat.
it sounds like it's a lot of fun here, though, because it's more than just one person going out. Like
even though I wasn't a big fan of Robin Hood, but the activism and the type of airplay that got was huge. Like, they were on Fox News. They were talking about it on all the comedian shows, late night comedian shows.
I've noticed that trend changing over the last year. That
nobody's done it.
The mainstream media actually talks about cop lockers a little bit. Some of them actually talk about them directly, some of them indirectly, but it gets talked about. It was just in my newspaper, my local news, that my next town over police chief retired, or no, not retired, I'm sorry, resigned. And his reason for resigning was, he worded it special, but it was like, constant day-to-day interference with our standard duties. Long story short, that was me with a camera.
There's too many
getting
donuts
them every
and too many
time,
dumps you
town,
had to take.
The town next to my town is like a two-mile-long town. It's this little town, and there's one road, and the cops pull them over along that road. So all I have to do is drive up and down that, and I'm going to film them. So I did that like every day, and apparently the police chief just...
Yeah, there's a whole string of stories from Trayvon Martin to Ferguson, all in that short period, has really changed people's perception of the police, and they're really starting to pay attention to how these people are trained and how they act on the job. It's great to see.
It hasn't had any effect on their ability to get away with murder, but it's had quite a bit of effect on the public's perception of them. I mean, Cop Block has, I believe last check was like 1.6, almost 1.7 million.
The morning of the raid, I think it was a distraction ploy, but we were actually talking to an officer for almost 2.5 hours, and it was about 4 in the morning, and it was like 20 degrees out. We were actually freezing our balls.
Think he knew?
What?
Think he knew?
He definitely
absolutely
knew.
Yeah. Absolutely.
He knew what was coming in a couple
hours?
Was
distracting us. He was distracting us from everything else that was going on.
Wow.
That, I know that's what it was. But we were talking to him for a long, long time, and I was telling him, I don't like your profession, the way you train, the way you think, everything. You're a douchebag. You wear a badge, you're a douchebag.
Well, we are at the half. We'll be back after a long commercial break, and I promise, guys, we will get to a couple stories tonight. We're just having some great talk. It's different being live in person. I'm enjoying it. We'll be right back with more Cop Block Radio.
I'll run the first segment.
No.
Welcome back to Cop Block Radio. This is not my fucking show. You're here with Renee Kate.
And J.P. Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block, and we have Ethan Glover of New Hampshire Regional Cop Block, and Severin is taking a minute break.
Yeah, a minute break that turned into him missing a segment of his show. Whoops. Aw, there they come.
Oh, hey, we're back on.
Don't worry, I got you. Guys, I'll just take over your show for you. All right, they're coming back in. I have no idea what the fuck you guys are talking about, but Anarchy After Dark. LRN.FM. Catch me Fridays, 10 p.m. to midnight. Because I'll let them have their show back now. All right, kids, have fun. Cop Lock stuff. Yeah, Cop Lock. Woo!
That's Renee K from Anarchy After Dark.
Professional.
Yeah.
This is what happens when we do a live show from the studio. We have all kinds of guests.
We were blindsided by the break. Accidentally. What was it? Only 6 minutes?
Yeah, it was like 6 minutes. I don't know. I was outside for a cigarette.
No way 8 minutes went by that quick.
I was enjoying.
You must have been enjoying your time out there. Are you good now? You got your cigarette in?
Yeah, I got
ready to go.
I got my nicotine. Listen, don't hate on the nicotine.
I was actually going to sit this segment out, but
that's okay.
Well, I'm glad you're here.
People want to hear you.
I want to hear your insight on this story that we have. We are going to do some stories tonight, guys.
Eventually. We'll get to it.
This is wild. It was written by Adama Freeman from copblock.org.
Who's that?
He's the founder. He's the co-founder of copblock.org.
I never met him.
Oh, my God. You're drinking. This guy drinks more Mountain Dew than I've ever seen. He came in with a 20-ounce bottle, and now he has a can.
Everybody's got a vice, man.
I do know Ademo, actually. Last time he was in Keene, I actually helped him move some stuff out of a storage unit. And he gave me this hat, actually. This Cop Lock hat that I wear was given to me by him. And he paid me in juicy other ways. Don't have a dirty mind about that, by the way.
Too late.
Just saying.
Way too late.
Demo's my boy.
Well, anyway, the story is about a new invention that was made.
It's the stand-up toilet. Here it is, right here, nice
and
shiny.
It is a cell phone gun.
That you can pee in.
No, it looks like an iPhone in a case, and it unfolds out to become a 380 cell phone handgun.
What the?
Sounds like a good way to get shot.
It's a 38 revolver?
380, it says. Is that a 38? I don't know gun. I don't know that stuff. I don't know guns.
It's basically what Ian's carrying.
I know that when you point at something and pull the trigger, it generally goes away.
And bad things happen, like loss of life.
Right.
Which I don't like.
No.
I'm not a big fan of guns.
Yeah, the only other thing I know about guns is when they're all around, things seem to be very safe.
It's true. If everyone's packing, nobody wants to do anything.
Nah, why would they?
Yeah,
until they have a psychotic break.
Is this gun like 3D printed, or who's selling
it? No,
honestly, this sounds like a good way. If you're pointing that thing at a cop, they're going to... They want that excuse to shoot somebody.
Well, I'm all for a second. I've been at the past three Second Amendment rallies at the State House here in New Hampshire,
right.
in Concord. I'm all for the rights of people carrying. Because if some douchebag comes into a school and all the teachers are packing, they're less likely to get through the door.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
It doesn't say who's...
But I'm personally not a big fan because I just don't like the fact of loss of life. I just don't like hearing about people dying. I don't like hearing people getting hurt, dogs being shot. I think most of all, people in power that carry them should be disarmed.
Well, this really, really scares me that this exists because I have personally seen cases where a cop stops you from filming and he claims his safety was at risk. Now, this was a friend of mine that had his phone snatched, and it turned into a whole thing. But for the cops now to be able to actually say that a cell phone could be a gun, it could be a weapon, now it's true.
What does this mean for cop blockers?
Does this mean that they're going to be able to, are they going to stop us all from filming and call?
I had an NYPD cop look right in my face while I had a camera right at his face, and he said right into the camera, "I'm going to think it's a gun. Put that fucking camera away." He said camera. He said, put the camera away. I'm going to think it's a gun. With his gun pointed right at me. I'm going to think it's a gun. I'm like, okay, you're going to think it's a gun. It's away. It's put away.
Yeah, well, we're going to get Officer Jumpy to, as soon as somebody pulls out their camera thinking, oh, it's just normal cop block, he's going to say, oh, he's coming at me, and he's going to get shot.
Yeah. Yep.
So does this? What do you think? Is this going to be open season for us?
It's another excuse. It's definitely another excuse. I mean, they don't even need an excuse. If you saw the videotape with me and Ethan, all he said was, yeah. That's all he said was, yeah. He just said he committed a crime. He just said it.
This after he asked me if I know about these apps that have like red and blue blinking lights. And I said, yeah. And that suddenly means that I was using one. Flashing on the lights, trying to pull people over was his accusation. There's nobody else on the road.
So if yeah is an excuse to arrest somebody and use a show of force or brute force, what do you think they're going to think if they think a cell phone is a gun?
That's my worry. They're going.
It's another excuse to kill somebody, another excuse to show force, another excuse.
Totally. Somebody's going to end up dead.
A bunch of people are going to
get
end
away
dead.
With it.
Yeah.
Or they're going to go into...
I highly suggest that if you're a cop locker or a cop watcher or oath accountability person or a watchdog group that goes after police and video records police, don't get the fucking thing. Don't get it.
Don't get what?
Don't get the handgun phone.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Oh, duh.
Not advisable.
Oh, man, I would... That'd be the dumbest thing for somebody to own. Why would you even want that?
It's worse than a selfie stick.
Oh man.
Oh Lord.
So I'm against it. I mean, I'm all for people being allowed to do whatever people want to do and own whatever they want to own. But I think that the idiot that thought this up, that made this, just really gave the police an excuse.
Yeah. It doesn't give them a legitimate excuse to, you know, think something's a weapon, but with the current state of things, they definitely are when they see something like that. It's definitely putting your life in danger if you're carrying that thing around.
Totally. That's why it's smart for any cop blocker to get a real DSL or DSLR or stand-up actual camera, video camera or a camera, because as far as I know, they haven't made any guns yet that look like a real one. Is that a body cam you got on you?
My backup.
That thing record 24 hours?
Pete carries one. I got one.
So you're recording me right now?
No, it's not on. This is my backup.
I'm calling the cops.
I'm wiretapping you, motherfucker.
I'll show you.
This is a two-party consent state. You're not in an open forum. You're under arrest. And then the feds are going to come into your building and steal all your equipment.
I don't know if you're in a radio studio. Do you still need consent?
That's a good question.
We're live on the air, so technically
it's an open forum.
It's an open forum,
and it's live on video already. Well, on the YouTube channel, anyway.
Conversations for another time. I want to jump into another story that was just breaking today. Jamar Clark was shot and killed by Dustin Schwartz, a Minneapolis police officer, last November. Dude, when I'm in the same room as you, you just can't keep laughing like that because I'm going to... He was shot last November, and several months after the attorney just released now that he will not face criminal prosecution.
Well, we're going to have to get back to that story because we have another break coming up on the the Cop Block radio show. I figured I'd give Seb a break on because I'm making him laugh.
I appreciate that. We'll be right back. We are back. A special episode live from LRN Studios. This is Severin Freeman from Lehigh Valley Cop Block.
Rick Gonzalez from Allentown Cop Block.
And we got Ethan Glover and J.P. Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block.
Before we went to the break, we were talking about the Jamarc Clark case. The DA in that case just announced that he will not be pressing charges. This announcement comes exactly 2 weeks after Freeman was praised by many for eliminating grand juries from the process of criminally charging killer cops. I read about that story. Did you? I thought this guy was good that he did this. And then a week later, he's saying that he's not going to charge the killer cop. So what's the point of getting rid of the grand juries if you yourself are going to just then say, no, I'm not charging them?
The back and forth, there may be some favoritism there. If he knows this guy or has some sort of connection, maybe third party.
I mean, this just goes along to support the opinion that all of these efforts to reform police are just straight. It's just a gimmick. It's just a show for everyone to feel good about a good story. The grand jury's getting eliminated, and then a week later, he sneakily tries to just get rid of the charges for a cop.
There's an idea that judges and law in general is going to be objective. That's never the case. There's always some sort of personal issue tied to it, something going on that's going to decide the case. It has nothing to do with what the actual law, objective law, which I don't think there is any such thing.
Of objective law.
Right, definitely not. I mean, everything is case by case. When they try to force this monopolized objective law into everyone, it's just something's going to go wrong somewhere.
Well, yeah, exactly. It's not objective. That's the problem. It's justice is supposed to be blind. But if you're rich or you're wear a badge or you're a friend of somebody important, you won't face the same criminal charges or the same consequences for your actions as, say, an average person walking down the street that just comes across a cop.
And that needs to change.
That's
the double standard needs to change because, you know, it's not fair. And people that don't commit any crimes are getting hurt. Like,
yeah, I mean, innocent people that cops know aren't going to stand up for themselves. They're just victims. You know, they'll write a ticket over a made up charge and they'll just go and pay it. I mean, they think this is normal life for most people. They've gotten used to it.
Well, I know before I took the red pill and saw the Matrix for what it was, like I said earlier, I didn't know that there was another way.
Oh, yeah, this is a ticket I got from a state trooper. Which one was this, JP?
I was talking about the ticket of us being distracted by the cops while we're talking to a cop.
Oh, yeah, this is happened the other night, like right before... the studios got raided by the FBI. We were actually talking to an officer for like 2 hours. And I got a ticket. Like when I got back to my car, someone was writing me a ticket for parking there. Overnight parking is what this thing is for. I mean, the streets are empty.
Did you use the I was with the cop card?
No, the guy actually just walked off. He wouldn't hear anything we were saying.
Were you in your recognized cop block mobile?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You think he might have just saw your car and decided?
It's probably retaliatory. Yeah. He probably saw us sitting there.
He was like, jackpot, got him.
Yeah. Finally got an opportunity to write these guys a ticket. There is a city ordinance that says you can't park between certain hours. They do that for the snow trucks, so they can push off the snow and not bury cars at the same time.
So the great thing is you could plead not guilty and subpoena the cop that you were talking to for 2 hours and make him have to come in.
Oh yeah, we were held busy by another police officer. That's on them. It's not like I was trying to park there for the night.
That's great. I love being able to get the cops to come into the courtroom and like. They parade us around and treat us like they can make us do whatever they want. It's nice when you get into a courtroom setting and they have to follow a certain set of rules. And it's kind
of
even though it's never really a fair fight, it's nice to be able to use the little tools that are at your disposal.
Yeah, they can't make up laws in court because they know the judge is going to knock any of that down. As long as, I mean, you got to be well informed too.
Well, what about when you go into court and I just lost my train of thought. I totally just lost what I was about to say. Oh, well.
Live on the radio.
I just had a brain fart. Oh, well, I just drove all the way here. Come on, guys. Like, feel sorry for me. I was up with a crying baby all night, though. Well, I'm going to let me get back to the rest of the story about the Jamar Clark case, because the officer not only won't be charged, but he's still on the job.
Why am I not surprised?
According to CBS Minnesota, Hennepin County Attorney Mike Freeman announced two Minnesota police officers will not be charged in the death of Jamar Clark. Officer Dustin Schwartz shot the 24-year-old last November in North Minnesota, Minneapolis. He was shot in the head on Plymouth Avenue North just before 1 a.m. on November 15, 2015. In announcing his decision, Freeman also shared a number of videos previously unreleased to the public. They show a citizen's view of the aftermath at the scene, as well as a series of videos from a camera fixed to the back of the ambulance that initially arrived at the scene that evening. There are videos shared with the district attorney's office. The first video received was when Clark was shot by the police. The video is pixelated and difficult to see exactly what is happening. But there is commotion. One person is heard yelling, "He didn't have to do that," in reference to the officer shooting Clark. The second video shows Clark on a stretcher being placed into the ambulance after the shooting. The third video shows Clark's girlfriend on a stretcher being placed into the ambulance. Clark is also nearby. She's placed into the ambulance, and Clark looks into the background. The officer's seen also speaking with Clark, who's just off camera. So it sounds like it's a bunch of videos that don't support the cops being let off. There's not enough being able to be seen. They didn't listen to the eyewitness testimony because they were going off these videos and saying there's not enough evidence to prosecute.
Well, hey, beyond a reasonable doubt, right?
But what's reasonable doubt? What does that even mean anymore? Reasonable doubt just means that the cop thought so.
Yeah.
Well, just another example of officer getting badge abuse.
And getting off on it. Yeah. Well, I mean, more ways than one, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, they got to collect a check. They got to kill somebody. They're walking the street. I personally don't know how somebody, like, how you can live with yourself. How do you walk around knowing that a life ended because of you?
Yeah, they're not totally ignorant of what they're doing.
They got ice in their veins.
Well, the problem is their training and all the people around them tell them they did the right thing. Mm. And there's nothing to worry about. And they had to preserve their own life. They fill them with all this garbage to let them get away with murder. We'll be right back. Cop Block Radio.
And we are back to the Cop Block Radio Show. Sev and me, JP Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block.
And Ethan Glover. I believe we got some... actually, you wanted to talk about the ridiculous
while we're on the
break, alcohol laws
while we're on
in
the
New
break,
Hampshire.
I'm sitting here, I look over, I'm like, hey, I can grab a six-pack when I get out of here. It's been a long day. I could really use a beer. Well, I turn a... These guys are looking at me like I'm from another country. Like, oh, it's almost midnight. You can't get a six-pack. Apparently in New Hampshire, there are laws that you can drink up until the bars close, but you can't get takeout?
Can't buy alcohol.
Tell me about this.
After 11.
I don't drink, so I don't have a freaking clue.
I've only been here a year. I don't know much about it. I don't drink either.
41 years, and I never touched one sip of an alcoholic beverage in my life. But it's 11 o'clock.
Rick doesn't drink either. So
11
I'm
o'clock.
I'm the lush in the room. Oh, well, I enjoy a beverage every now and then, but I'm shocked to find out that I'm an adult. It's not even midnight, and I can't get a drink in this town.
One time everyone actually wants to drink, it's not available because government.
Yeah, because government, because they said so.
Well, be a responsible adult. Buy it early. Buy a few packs and wait till midnight and drink it then.
I thought I was coming to a freer state where I could purchase it at all hours of the night.
24/7, damn it.
I just say no to drugs.
Well, the difference is, though, that it's not a state store here that sells it. What kind of stores sell alcohol? Everything?
They have Packies. They got the New Hampshire State Liquor Store.
So can I, and if I go into a grocery store, do they sell alcohol here?
Supermarkets sell it here. Do you know in Massachusetts
just
only...
Just beer, or is it liquor, too?
Yeah, both. In Massachusetts, only one shopping center per franchise is allowed to sell alcohol. So let's say Stop and Shop has like 100 stores. Only one of their stores can sell it.
What?
Yeah.
Well, because government, right?
Because government.
Because it's because mass. Government. Mass. Well, in Massachusetts, blinking your eyes on Saturday between the hours of 3 and 4 is probably a felony.
Really? That's pretty. I don't know.
I'm kidding, but
I'm coming
that's how
out here
ridiculous
wanting the free state, and I'm not feeling very free. I can't get off the air and go have a beer. What's up with that?
There are pros and cons. I think
what about Pennsylvania's ridiculous wiretapping laws?
I thought New Hampshire had the same thing.
Not for long. It should be. I mean, right now it's 2-party consent state, New Hampshire. But it should.
But
it
you
looks
can
like
record an open forum, though, here.
I, as far as I know, anytime you record a cop, even if he's with a civilian, it's legal in all 50
definitely.
States. And that's all I'm really worried about. I did have a situation where a regular civilian started
it's
with me.
It's 51 and a half states that we have.
Well, 51 and a half?
Yeah.
How's that?
It's 51 and a half.
How's that work?
Well, you forgot the half state, which is the Commonwealth, which is Puerto Rico.
Oh, okay.
And D.C.
Okay. They don't count.
I think it's all one big state. Let's be honest. It's all the same thing.
It's interesting to hear about the different laws, though, and the different, like, I noticed, I think it was through Connecticut, that they use blue lights, the only solid blue lights to pull people over.
They only have solid blue lights here.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not red. It's
Massachusetts,
not red.
Massachusetts, New York. Here.
See, I'm glad you tell me that, because if I had somebody behind me with just blue lights, I think I would have ignored it. I would have thought it was like an emergency vehicle, and like I would have been waving them. Go around, dickhead.
You've seen more videos than anyone, and you never realize most of them all have blue lights.
I don't pay attention to these things.
Oh man.
I'm taking notes on like funny things.
See, maybe it is good that you do move here and you only can get alcohol at 11 o'clock. I'm just kidding.
Are you saying I have some brain cells, Dad?
No.
Maybe.
A couple.
I think you're exhausted from your drive. Yeah, driving takes a lot out of you.
I am really exhausted.
Especially for old men like me.
Hey, you did the trip up. You're going to do it again soon, right?
Yeah.
You're talking about coming up, but I'm going to... I'm going to look up to see when events are. I know
Officer Peacock, part 3.
I know August is when Music Fest is in my town, and you've never experienced what Music Fest does.
You guys got to come up for Bike Week.
What's that? When
in
is
Laconia
it?
Laconia Bike Week.
When is that?
Every law enforcement agency in the state shows up with at least a cop. Yeah.
They've totally shut that
like
place down.
To show their bikes off or to show up to shut it down?
No, they
write tickets, collect revenue.
Over 10,000 to 20,000 bikers come to New Hampshire during that week.
That's insane.
But I hear it's been shrinking because of the cop presence.
That's exactly what's happened at Keene State College. Mm. They will show up because of the riots in 2014. Because of the riots at Keene State College.
What started the riots? You were telling me
we
about
think
that.
We think the cops did. Because if you look at my cop lock videos from 2013 on Pumpkin Fest, and then look at 2014 during Pumpkin Fest, these guys were in riot gear by 11:30, by noontime, when nothing was even going on yet. Now, in 2013, it was fine. Kids had a lot of parties. They had fun, blah, 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 blah. Everybody moved on. And, you know, what happened was there was a cop posted on Blake Street, and these two fraternities were having a bottle war with each other, throwing bottles at each other. It was peaceful at first, and a kid got hit. Somebody got in a fight. And then some girl threw a bottle off her porch. It accidentally rolled and hit a cop. He runs up on the porch, and mind you, there are thousands of people. Like, you literally have to bump people all the way up. So this cop, with his gear on, goes up to a Blake Street house and drags the chick by her hair, thump, 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 down the stairs, and all fucking hell broke loose from there. It was done by then. And we're talking fires, turned over cars, wow, millions of dollars worth of damage, helicopters in the sky with spotlights making people go home, riot police, pepper balls.
Was there a lot of property damage, storefronts?
No storefronts. This was all located in the college area. You could see videos. Free Keens got videos. Activists from Free Keens got videos.
I have videos. Check that out.
It was nuts. It was absolutely nuts. I was smack dab in the middle of it. I got shot 13 times by pepper balls from paintball guns. And guess what? They don't fucking break. They just hit you at 1400 PSI and leave like welts with blood coming out of it. Yeah. I have pictures of it.
Wow.
I got pictures of the welts.
Yeah,
I headbutted and had my nose broken by a state trooper and got trampled and hit in the back of the head by a metal light post.
Did you catch any charges?
No.
So all that violence and they didn't even...
Hundreds of people got charged. Hundreds of people got charged. Mm. Hundreds of people. But guess what? You know what they're doing now? During the beginning of the year in September when school opened, cops were showing up just at a mere noise complaint with 13 cops. You got to turn this down or you're going to get a ticket. With 13 cops. And it's not even a party going on. There might be like 8 kids in there.
They've got that many cops patrolling around the main street when there's nothing going on at 2 in the morning.
It doesn't make any sense. Keene State College has lost over 300 students on transfers because of the police presence. They're losing money. The city's losing money. And let them screw themselves. It's no fun to be a college kid in Keene anymore. Hmm. I was like a celebrity doing Cop Lock there for the past, you know, 3 or 4 years. This year sucked.
We're cutting to a commercial break. We're going to be back with our last segment.
Badges don't grant extra rights and cops suck.
Nice doing this live in the studio. I'm having a good time.
It's comfy.
Thank you guys for hosting us out here. It's great. We'll be right back. We are back with our final segment of the night. I gotta say, it's been great doing this live, but it's been a long day.
Poor guy.
Yeah. Well, I'm debating. Is it legal to buy caffeine this late at night in the state? Is Dunkin' Donuts still open?
I don't know, man. This is some pretty serious stuff, you can get away with it.
It's hard drugs, I know, but I'm leaning toward some caffeination and some cop blocking. Caffeination and cop blocking tonight.
Huh. I'm ready. Let's do it.
Do a little Keene cop blocking.
Let's roll through some Keene. Let's do it. We got 10 minutes left on the air. Let's go Keene, find
police.
A stop.
Yeah.
You guys got like a police radio?
Oh yeah, I got the scanner in the car.
Awesome.
Really? So we can literally find a stop, definitely,
and pull up right next to it, huh?
And pull up next to it.
Get right up behind him.
We have state police, sheriff's department, towns all over the state.
Everyone.
So you heard it here first on Cop Block Radio, an impromptu meetup / cop blocking event happening right here in Keene in 10 minutes.
With the Cop Block Mobile, 360-degree cameras.
So meet us outside LRN Studios. We'll be on our way to film some cops and get some great footage. I can't wait to meet one of your local cops. I printed up special baseball card playing cards with me on them, with my stats.
Your just stats?
To give to police.
What are your stats? This sounds amazing. I already want one of my own.
Well, I am the founder of Lehigh Valley Cop Block. I host Cop Block Radio. I don't even know all it says.
You got to have a number count on there with the number of blocks you've done or something. Estimated blocks.
Yeah, I have to update the card, actually, because I would really like to put some of our accomplishments on there, like taking on City Hall and winning. But, yeah.
Number of chiefs gotten fired, one.
Yeah.
You made these for me and Jess.
Yeah. Yeah, I did. That's right. I made a few for you while you were up in town. That was great. You gave one to the cop. He lost. He
called the cops.
Yeah. J.P. Freeman, while he was in our town, gives a cop one of these playing cards that we had made up with his information, founder Keen Coplock. Well, the cop didn't know what to do with J.P., and he left and decided to call Keene, New Hampshire Police Department and say, do you know who J.P. Freeman is?
And you could find that video on Allentown Cop Block on YouTube. It's labeled Allentown Police Meet J.P. Freeman.
Yeah, that was
panic.
It was pretty funny. We had wrapped up the night. We're in the car on our way back home, just done for the evening. And JP's phone rings in the back seat, and he's like, "Hey, wait, this is a Keene number." He answers the phone.
The police officer in Keene totally told Allentown PD, "This is a closed record state, and if it was anybody else, I'll tell you anything you want to know, but not JP. You're going to have to file a report, file a 91A request, go through the right channels, because I want nothing to do with that fucking kid."
Do you think that they I mean, I know the cops follow my Facebook page. Do you think that they figured out that you were from out of town and they're just thankful you're gone?
Probably.
I don't want to tell them when you're coming back. I don't want to announce like a meetup event. I want it to be a surprise.
I've been surprised by the number of cops who actually pay attention to what we're doing, they're watching the YouTube videos and everything. And
oh, absolutely.
And we talked to one the other night that he says he's hoping he shows up on one because it makes him a celebrity or whatever.
Yeah, I have the chief of one of the towns near me that runs the DUI checkpoints that is the star of my very most popular video. It's up to over 500,000 views.
Wow.
And he is the star. It's me at his police station schooling him on the law. And it was just beautiful. Rick was there. My wife was there. This was when I first started. Rick had just signed on. At this point, it was my wife coming out with me and filming me. And she hated it.
That guy's fake as shit.
Oh, you know who JP needs to meet?
Who's that?
Sergeant Gross.
Oh, man.
Step back. Step back. He'll tell you to step back when you're filming. I would like to see him meet you.
Yeah, well, we're
going to need you to step back.
We went in and filed a full internal affairs complaint against Sergeant Gross for harassing us, and they found it. Here's how fun internal affairs is. They found our claim justified. We were harassed and wronged. His consequence was dealt with at the shift level. Nothing was put in his file. Nothing was done to him at all. His supervisor told him not to do that again.
Got his wrist slapped.
That was his punishment.
Yeah.
He got a little... I mean...
Same thing's probably going to happen with the rookie officer, too.
Realize when I hear this that this guy probably thinks he's kind of hot shit. He walks around with this, like, wannabe Hawaiian haircut. He thinks he's like this hot shit
Ace Ventura
guy.
Haircut.
So it's really, really great when I get to sit back and picture his pride, his ego get scratched a little bit because his supervisor called him in and said, "You got in trouble with those cop blockers? Like, it's supposed to be amateur hour, like getting in trouble with us because they tell them to avoid us. Like, they're supposed to be trained to deal with this and they don't know what to do around us. It's great.
Because you know those cop blockers, if you get around them, and they're going to incriminate you.
Yeah,
same thing they do to people. We'll do it right back.
I asked one of the high ups at one of my local police departments for an interview, and he said, "No, I'm not. I can't give you an on camera interview because I know you guys just edit all your videos to make us look bad."
Oh, come on!
Like, get out of here! I have not done that.
Yeah.
Well, I might have done that once or twice, like just as a humor thing, though. Like, had the cop say something stupid and then had the video repeat what he said like a couple times. But hey, it's for emphasis. It's for fun.
Right.
We're both educational and entertainment. It's a full package at Cop Block.
I mean, across the board, I think most cop blockers never edit anything. It's all raw video. For most of what I've seen, there's not a lot of editing going on, and for good reason.
Yeah, I mean, I edit my stuff. I do put in an intro and all that, but I try to leave all of the contact there. Yeah. If there's a boring time where I'm standing around for 10 minutes waiting for the cop, I obviously edit that out. Well, it's the only way they can try to save face when they look that bad to someone who's like, I'm not a professional. Like, I haven't had training. I didn't go through school, and I can make you look this dumb. It's pretty nice to be able to school a cop on the law and on things, and just especially a police chief.
Oh yeah, that's got to be some fun times.
Yeah, I sent him a nice email with all the laws that he had broken, and he sent back an email acknowledging that he was wrong in several instances.
Nice.
It was one of the top five cop blocking moments of my life, probably best time of my life right there. That next to watching the guy that told me I couldn't come in without ID into City Hall. Watching him have to suck it up and put his tail between his legs and let me in and hand me a badge.
What, was this a security guard?
Yeah, well, I had a whole battle with my local City Hall. You can see it on Lehigh Valley Cop Block's YouTube channel. It's a whole entire instance that happened. I just went there for an information request, and I realized that they had a policy in place that they weren't letting people in the building without ID. So it turned into an entire event for me. It was like my coming out party for Cop Block because it was my first official Cop Block event. I protested for a week. I went there every day with signs. I got news coverage. I got all kinds of stuff. They realized the ACLU ended up making a statement about it saying that their policy is unconstitutional.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so they ended up having to change their policy. That was probably one of the I had so many people telling me on the news reports and like talking trash about me, saying you can't fight City Hall, who's this loser, no one cares, blah blah blah. That moment when I heard that they changed their policy was like, yeah, that's nice. Like icing on a beautiful cake, right?
Makes
there.
It all worth it.
Yeah.
Hey, before we go, we actually missing someone tonight named Tim Sanborn. It's Brattleboro Cop Block, a chapter that I founded. He had some impacted teeth removed today, so he was like highly inebriated. He couldn't drive. So I just want to give a shout out to him, and thanks for thinking of us, and sorry you couldn't come.
Yeah, definitely. Come up on one of the future days that we're here. I'd love to meet you. I hope you feel better. We're coming up to the end of the show. You can find me at Lehigh Valley Cop Block on Facebook and on YouTube and on Twitter and all of your social media needs.
And you can find me on Allentown Cop Block on YouTube and Facebook. And a shout out to some of my podcast hosts, Oath Accountability, check them out, and the County Cop Block.
Carbon County Cop Block.
Did I say that right?
No. Our usual co-host, Matt
Matt Taylor.
Who couldn't make it down here to Keene, but he is the head of Carbon County Cop Block. You can also check out Oath Accountability Project. That's his other project.
CopBlock.org, Facebook, and YouTube.
Yes, check out the CopBlock.org/groups. To find a group near you and the store.
And the CopBlock.org/store to get all your gear, all your Cop Block gear.
Download Cell 411. I recommend it.
And New Hampshire Regional Cop Block and New Hampshire Regional Cop Block YouTube channel. Check out Ethan and Ethan Glover and JP Freeman on the Rollin' podcast and the mini cast.